It was the most powerful machine ever created, and it still is to this day. Imagine sitting on the top of the world's tallest firecracker, 35 stories tall, filled with millions of gallons of fuel. When it goes up, the Saturn V rocket can put out 20 tons of, burn up 20 tons of fuel a second and put out 7.5 million pounds of thrust. It was the first time used with Apollo 8, because that was the first mission that was going to go and circle the moon. And it was incredibly risky. The commander, Frank Borman, said our primary mission was to go to the moon, circle it 10 times, and come home alive. He was joined by two other crewmen, Bill Anders in the middle, and Jim Lovell, who you probably know for saving Apollo 13. Well, Bill Anders said that he thought they had a 1 in 3 chance of not coming back. When the first rocket took off, he said the sideways shaking was so unbelievable. The vibration was so intense, you couldn't see the instrument panel. I thought we had it on that launch, which took off on December 21st, 1968. Then they were beyond the speed of sound within 1 second. And then soon, 5 more rockets hit with the second stage. Bill said, the second stage cut in, big bang, I thought we were being catapulted through the instrument panel. By the time the third stage went, they were beyond the Earth, and they had gone farther than any other humans had ever been before. That gut-churning journey caused Commander Frank Borman to throw up in zero gravity. Imagine the mess it created inside the capsule. But it didn't matter. Whatever it took, they were going. Apollo 8 went up with a glorious blaze of light while the world watched in awe. It was their time to shake and shine. Woodside, now is our time to shake and to shine. But we are not being launched like Apollo 8 out of this world. No, God is launching us into this world. We begin today our fall series, In, Not Of. Jesus wants to send us into the world, but not to be of the world, to be like the world. Instead, he wants us to live differently. And we're in such a difficult time right now, a divisive time. Doesn't it seem like you're walking on a knife edge between one side and the other, and there are people on both sides saying, come on over on our side. If you don't join our side, you are on the outside. When it comes to the world, it's tempting either to imitate the world or just isolate from it. To assimilate or segregate, to blend in or block it all out. Sometimes you feel like you're being called to dive into a sea of conformity, and the next minute you just want to run away to the security, the separateness of a holy huddle. But Jesus calls us to do something different. In the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus teaches a different message. He says, live in this world, but don't be like it. Be like him. Live like him. He's showing us how we, in the Sermon on the Mount, can be citizens of the kingdom of heaven while we are living among the kingdoms of this world. We're going to discover how it is possible to let his kingdom come and his will be done on earth as it is in heaven, in you and me. And he begins by telling us to shake and to shine. He says in the beginning of the Sermon on the Mount, just after the Beatitudes, you are the salt of the earth. But if the salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It's no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled by men. You are the light of the world, a city on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before men, that they may see your good deeds and praise your Father in heaven. Two things, salt and light, both essential for life. Salt is shaken, light shines. And Jesus says both of them belong out in the world. He doesn't want us to keep them to ourselves. He wants us to share them with others. Salt is so essential for life. Salt is used in greater quantities and for more applications than any other mineral. It has more than 14,000 known uses. Everyone uses salt directly or indirectly. Americans each consume more than 16 tons of salt during their lifetimes, 402 pounds in just 1 year for every living American, and only a small percentage of that massive amount is ingested as food. Salt, Jesus says, is something we need to have for the earth. What does he mean by that? There's two things we must do if we want to put the salt out, and that is, first, we can't keep our Christian faith in this building. Only be Christians while we're in here. He doesn't want us to keep it hidden in this big salt shaker we call a sanctuary. He wants it to be out in the world. But he also says we don't need to be and want to be salt light. He says in the scriptures, if the salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It's no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled by others. Now, scientists have a problem with this. They say, you know, if you know chemistry, sodium chloride, table salt, can't lose its saltiness. Now, and Jesus, he's the creator of chemistry. Why doesn't he know this? But you see, commentators tried to respond to them. They said, well, you know, what Jesus is talking about here is sort of a diluted, low-grade salt mixed with other minerals. It's kind of diluted. That's what he's talking about. But that actually misses the point of what Jesus is saying. Let me show you something. The Greek for the phrase loses its saltiness is morain, where we get our word moron. It means foolish, unwise, silly. Probably the best translation, which captures the double meaning, is tasteless. What Jesus is saying is, if you're going to share my good news, don't be tasteless. Don't do and say things that are foolish, silly, dumb, obnoxious, offensive. Share my salt in a way that brings truth and love, joy, and life. Why does the world need Jesus' salt? Well, for one thing, salt preserves lives. They didn't have refrigeration back then. The only thing they could do to keep meat from spoiling, from bacteria growing, from corruption happening, is to put salt all over it. And in the same way, Jesus is asking us to be out in the world with his salt to prevent corruption and spoiling. And there's two types, two forms of corruption in society and in the soul. Nowadays, you hear some people say, you know, we really need to address the problems of society, the injustice, the ills. We need to combat them and fight them. But at the same time, they say, you know, we want to encourage people to just kind of do whatever is good to them and pleases them and makes them happy. Whereas there are other people that say people need to, like, clean up their act and start to live right and have better behavior. But as far as the society or business or whatever, we need to leave off any kind of control and don't tell people what to do. Now, both sides are right and both sides are wrong. And Jesus tells us to do something different from both of them. For the record, he never told the government what it should do or not do, but his focus is solely on his followers. And in saying that, and as you'll see as we go through the Sermon on the Mount, he addresses both issues. He challenges selfishness in the soul. Do not give in to anger. Do not obey lust. Do not break up relationships. Do not run after money. Do not judge. At the same time, in the same sermon, he attacks the sickness in society. Reconcile before you go to court. Keep your promises. Practice nonviolence. Love your enemies. Give to the needy. Why? Because Jesus knows that if you don't address the sickness and sin in the soul, it's going to lead to a corrupt society. And if you don't address the corruption in society, it's going to encourage people to be selfish in their souls. So he asks us to go out there and do both. But to start, not with others, but with ourselves. To let his salt come in and kill off the bacteria, the corruption, the infection inside each one of us. In Jesus' day, the place where they would get salt is the Dead Sea. And they actually also called it the Salt Sea because the salt concentration is so high there. In fact, the salt concentration is so high that you actually bob on the top of the water. You cannot sink even if you wanted to. The concentration of salt is so high because the altitude of the Dead Sea is so low. It is the lowest place on the face of the earth. That means that everything flows into it and nothing flows out of it. You might actually say that the Dead Sea is the most selfish body of water on earth. It takes everything in and gives nothing away, and that's why it's dead. God wants us to take in his salt to cleanse our own selfishness, but then also to pass it on and give it away so it will help and preserve souls and societies. He then says that we need to live not like the world, but be sharing it out in the world. And what I'm going to ask you to do over the next 8 weeks is join us on this journey. As we dig in, as we mine the salt out of his sermon and find out how we can apply it. And you can do that by being here in worship. And if you're not here, if you're not in town, you can see the services online. But I encourage you to be sticking with us as we go through each one of these in powerful teachings. I also am going to ask you to get into a growth group. They're starting right now. Many of them are doing this study. I actually do one on Monday nights on Zoom, so if you can't get out or get to one of these groups, it's 1 hour, Monday night, 7 o'clock. Just put it on the connection card or on this form, and I'll give you the Zoom link. Everyone's welcome, but there are many other groups that will be doing this all through the week. And I also encourage you to find in your handout this bookmark, which lists the verses that we're going to be studying. And on the back, they're short readings, very short readings. You can look at the passages 7 different ways during the week so you can get the most out of what God is saying through the Sermon on the Mount. So I encourage you to be part of that as we go forward to live his way in this world. Because the other thing that salt does is it heals lives. Salt on a wound is stinging, very stinging, but it was the only way they could stop gangrene in the past before they had medicines. So that's another way that salt helps in our society. Our God's salt is it heals. It brings wholeness. It brings life. When I was in the Dominican Republic, I was drinking Gatorade, and the Gatorade in my bottle was blue. And people would look at me drinking that blue Gatorade because I drank a lot of it, and they'd say, that looks like you're drinking Windex or from the Tidy Bowl. Or it looked like embalming fluid, they said, and that was because it looked like I was about to die. But I was drinking all of that Gatorade because the salts in it were replacing the salt I was losing when I was sweating doing all that work. We need salt to bring healing into our lives. And last week you heard from Seber Banda about how they face incredible challenges. They only have 2 pastors for 80 different churches in their area. They have women who die on the way to giving birth because they don't have the midwives and clinics to help them in their own location. They have chronic diseases like cholera and malaria and HIV, they're just spreading everywhere, and they have their water sources are tainted with illnesses that kill children, teens, and adults. But you heard how through her work, they are pushing back against those illnesses with God's salt and light. And that's true also in Zambia and in the Bahamas and in the Dominican Republic and in Haiti. And that is, you are there with them, helping them heal. Through your gifts, through the missionaries you send, through the people that go out there to do that work. You're there bringing the salt and light and healing those communities. And the last thing is that salt flavors lives. Imagine how bland food would be without it. And yet, here's a funny thing about chemistry. Pure sodium, if you mix it with water, is explosive. And chlorine is that poisonous gas which has the strong smell you smell in bleach. Separately, they are very deadly, but together, they make sodium chloride, which is table salt, that actually, when added to food, brings out the flavor. David Johnston says this, "Love and truth can be like sodium and chlorine. Love without truth is flighty, sometimes blind, willing to combine with various doctrines. On the other hand, truth by itself can be very offensive, sometimes even poisonous. Spoken without love, it can turn people away from the gospel. But when truth and love are combined in an individual or a church, then we have what Jesus calls the salt of the earth. And we're able to preserve and bring out the beauty of our faith." You heard about Mozambique last week. Let me also tell you about Zambia, which is the country next door. You generously supported the rebuilding of the Mandevu School, putting a new roof on it, painting the walls, fixing the floor. But what about the children in the school? They were still sitting cramped, four to a desk, and the desks were in terrible conditions. They reached out to us and asked us if we would do something about it. And the women from our spring women's retreat, plus the children of our Woodside Christian Preschool during their walkathon raised funds to buy these brand new desks. I just received pictures this week from them telling us thank you for what you do. And you went beyond that and gave $17,000 to train evangelists to bring the truth of God's love to the world, to flavor it and bring life and joy and peace. Jesus ends this passage by saying, "You are the light of the world." People don't light a lamp and put it under a bowl. No, what do? They put it on a stand. It gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before men, women, that they may see your good deeds and praise your Father in heaven. Light shines not so you look in the light, but so that the light shows you the way. Salt doesn't call attention to itself, but it brings out the flavor. You and I need to shine our light and shake out the salt, not so we draw attention to ourselves, but give glory to God. How do you do that? Here's some suggestions. Contribute to Applepalooza or the food drive. Help teach children in Sunday school. We need teachers for Sunday school. Invite someone to your growth group, join a growth group, invite someone to worship with you. Go even farther, start a microchurch at work in your neighborhood. Tell someone who doesn't go to church one thing you learned from the sermon or your Bible reading. Pray and ask God to guide you as you consider how to vote this November. Don't listen to anyone else, listen just to the Lord. Because the world is a turbulent and divided place, but let me tell you about another time that was very turbulent. 1968 was one of the most divided times in American history. In our cities, there was rioting, there was fighting. The Democratic National Convention that year was disrupted by riots. The Cold War was expanding. At the same time in Vietnam, 1,200 soldiers were being killed, American soldiers, each month. In April of that year, the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King was assassinated. And then later in the summer, Bobby Kennedy was also assassinated. This was the fragile, divided, broken world that Frank Borman, Bill Anders, and Jim Lovell left behind when on December 21st, 1968, they soared into the sky on Apollo 8 to circle the moon. On December 24th, Christmas Eve, they had a live broadcast from out in space. And they sent back one of the most iconic pictures NASA ever showed, a picture of a tiny, fragile, blue, white ball rising up over the horizon of the moon. And on that live broadcast on Christmas Eve, NASA gave them an opportunity to share some appropriate thoughts. That's all they said, just share some appropriate thoughts. So this was their opportunity. They could have talked about the great achievements of humanity that had brought us so far. They could have lauded such scientists as Newton or Einstein that paved the way. They could have said, "Rah, USA, we are beating the Soviet Union in the space race." They could have even shared some kind of political agenda in that moment. But instead, what they chose, all three astronauts shared the reading of these words. "In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth, and the earth was formless and void, and darkness was on the face of the deep. And God said, 'Let there be light,' and there was light. And God saw that light was good. To a fractured, frail, weary world, these astronauts shone the light and gave glory to God." Woodside, as you go out into this world, it's your turn and mine to shake and shine. Will you pray with me? Lord, show, please, each one of us who needs your salt and your light. Help us to shine and share your good news in a way that helps heal, preserve, and bring joy to life. We pray this in your name, Jesus. Amen.